I want to welcome you to the IMD and You Day. Has it been a good day so far? All right, wonderful. I hear that there's been some very good panels, but I think we've saved the best panel for last. My name is Crystal Thomas. I am the Deputy Governor here in Illinois, and I'm really honored to be included in this event and to be moderating the Clinical Data and Translational Research Panel. And I think that we're really in for a great discussion today. We have an esteemed panel, as you can see, to talk about their work and the research that is happening right here in the IMD that's affecting patients both here in Chicago and Illinois and really, I think, worldwide. So let me do an introduction of our panelists. First, we have Dr. Jay Shannon, who is Chief Executive Officer of the Cook County Health and Hospital System. We have Dr. Elena Barangoltz, who is Associate Professor of Medicine at the University of Illinois Chicago and Chief of Endocrinology, Diabetes, and Metabolism at the Jesse Brown VA Medical Center. We have Dr. Jim Mulsheen, Associate Provost, Vice President for Research, and Director of the Rush Translational Sciences Consortium at Rush University Medical Center. And hopefully, who will be joining us later is Dr. Robert Nguyen, who is Associate Vice President for Community-Based Practice and Director of the Lung Cancer Program at University of Illinois Hospital and Health Sciences System. So I am going to start out this morning just asking each of our panelists to give about 5-minute overview of their work and their research here. And then I have some questions that we'll go through, and hopefully we just want to have a dialogue, you know, up here to talk about translational research and the importance of it and some of the latest developments. And we will leave time at the end, of course, for our audience questions and participation. So I will start with Dr. Shannon, if you want to give us an overview of what's happening at the Cook County Health and Hospital System.
Sure. Thanks for inviting me. I think the general comments that I would make is that for the county health system, what we're looking at is an opportunity both with the way that we're transitioning as a healthcare system and with some of the opportunities that we have through emerging innovations, particularly around things like electronic information that are a relatively recent phenomenon in healthcare. They've been around for a long time in banking and other things like that, but relatively recent phenomenon for healthcare. They give an opportunity for an organization like ours to exploit the resource that we've had for a long time. That resource is large numbers of patients, to do a better job to answer questions that are of immediate clinical concern to the patients that we have. So different from some of the other organizations that are on the panel today, including U of I and Rush and the VA, which many people think of as traditional, if you will, academic health centers, the county system has always been traditionally academic in the sense of our learning, but it's been a relatively smaller performer as it relates to independent funding for what people would call or might refer to as research with a big R. I think we've got an opportunity to change that. We'll talk about this a little bit more, I think, later on today. But we've got a particularly unique opportunity to change that now as our health system has transformed in the past 2 years from, if you will, solely a provider of care, which we've done since our inception in 1835, to now a healthcare provider that also has nested within it a health insurance plan. And that health insurance plan has more than 100,000 members. And so as we think about the opportunities that information has to inform how we can improve health, I think we've got a different opportunity today than we did a few years ago. And I hope we can explore that in our conversation.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. And now I'll turn to Dr. Elena Barangoltz.
Thank you. And I can say that I am staying at University of Illinois and at Jesse Brown VA now for more than 25 years. And I can say that perhaps because I'm in both systems for so long, starting there as a fellow, I perhaps have a unique perspective on comparing the systems, and I can say that for research, it provides a unique environment because you can tap in translational research and clinical research and basic science simultaneously and connect them, because University of Illinois has a wonderful basic science base and has a core lab and core research facility that I, as a clinical researcher, use extensively. And again, we can explore it later. From the VA part, I can say that, for example, electronic records and electronic use of electronic media potential that is available at VA is probably advanced compared to other systems because it's simply federally integrated systems, and other facilities perhaps can learn, because, for example, we utilize heavily electronic consults and telemedicine already, and that experience can be perhaps tapped into research and also integrated with other systems and collaborating with other places that are just a block away from us would be a wonderful experience, and we can learn more, perhaps more during our further conversation. But just last thing that you can later ask me about is that the innovative research that my grant was recently involved with includes pre-diabetes, which is preventive medicine, where I think potential is also underrepresented in the research population at VA, which is African American and low socioeconomic status population, and microbiome and microbiota, which again is a wonderful place now to be for translational research. Those elements were integrated into my recent studies, and I can expand on that if the audience is interested in.
Wonderful, thank you. And I'm sure we will be interested in expanding on some of those points, and particularly about the underrepresentation of preventive medicine and translational research. I think that's important. And I know that there was an earlier panel that was talking about the Patient-Centered Outcomes Research Institute grant, the PCORI Capricorn Initiative, and you know that whole idea of connecting what we know in clinical research to those patient outcomes and what will actually achieve the best patient outcomes. I think there is an opportunity for us to make sure that that, and we're working to make sure that prevention is a part of you know that plan. And I'm happy to welcome Dr. Nguyen, who has joined us. I did introduce you even in your absence, so I will turn to Dr. Mulshin next to just kind of give us an overview of his work and perspective.
Thank you very much. And I also want to thank the IMD for pulling us all together today. They've done a wonderful job as a convener. And there's fertile ground to plow. So I asked a very challenging question in the previous panel about, you know, how do you take some of our drug development models and move them into the age of new medicine, or the age of population-based health. And it's a challenge that we all wrestle with. But one of the key opportunities we have is to use information much more efficiently in the drug development process. And so, you know, one palpable example of this comes out of the interaction you've heard about Capricorn already. And currently, Capricorn is involved in a new grant, we use academic mechanisms, where an investigator at in Boston has been working on developing a post-marketing infrastructure for the FDA for drug development. And this Sentinel program is the next potential opportunity for these Capricorn and other, what they call CDRNs, Clinical Data Research Network members, to gather data across the board on all of the millions of lives that come into their data repositories and use it to look for complications or early problems with people that have gotten new drugs. Because when a company develops a drug for a new indication, typically in the course of drug development, it may have used that particular compound and maybe 10,000, 20,000 people.
The on button is a good thing. But in the process of that first year of its use and dissemination, it may be used in a million people. And so complications that were invisible in the early stages of drug development wind up being a big problem for particular individuals that might have lethal complications. And so we need a better surveillance system to learn about this. Because in the past, you know, as a part of accelerated approval, the FDA has asked drug companies to do post-marketing on their own. And there's mechanisms in order to do this, which are extraordinarily expensive. And then deconvoluting mysteries like, was the person who just died from the complication of that drug a male or a female, cannot be reestablished. It is profoundly difficult to capture that kind of information in a meaningful way. The FDA tried it itself. With the release of the papillomavirus vaccine, they tried to set up an early warning system, and they captured data from like the first 20 or so million people who got the multivalent vaccine for papillomavirus, which is an incredibly important public health tool that we now have. Even with their absolute utmost efforts, for the small number of people that actually died in a time associated with the administration of the vaccine, they couldn't figure out if these people got hit by a bus or it was actually a medical complication of the vaccine. Now, it turns out through time, fortunately, the vaccine was okay. But it just points out the challenge we have of trying to get a very important understanding of how these drugs perform in populations. And so the PCORI Institute is trying to create an infrastructure of capturing data to start understanding dynamics at a community-based level. And it's a profoundly important gesture. Now, as a byproduct of this, there's other things that emerge as opportunities that could impact the cost of the $150,000 for a course of a life-saving medication. And one example that one of our faculty members, Mary Hayden, in the Department of Infectious Diseases at Rush, the infectious diseases at Rush work very closely. They're integrated with the infectious diseases at County, and there's been shared surveillance activities going back a long time, led by Bob Weinstein at County, trying to understand how information could assist that process in understanding emergences of biological threats or whatnot. In this particular instance, Mary Hayden was part of a collaboration of national hospital systems that had EHRs. These all happened to be Epic. And the leader of this trial said, wait a second, we're going to do this trial, but the parameters that we're going to follow all have to be items that are part of routine care that are routinely entered into the Epic database in a consistent way. And we're going to look at three interventions to try to reduce the occurrence of MRSA in intensive care unit populations, because if you get a MRSA infection, there's a fairly predictable consequence of that that involves additional hospitalization to receive intensive antibiotics to overcome the resistance of that Staphylococcal aureus. So they did this three-armed randomized trial, and the only data was acquired from the Epic system. And they were able to clearly show that one of the interventions was profoundly or statistically much more significant in reducing MRSA. And as a result of that, they're able to understand from the previous experience that this was associated in this unit of ICU beds of about a $17 million a year reduction in cost. Now, the reduction in cost for the hospital is just gravy. The fact that they only had to download their data from Epic to actually conduct that study is the real economic saving. Because as we all know, doing these clinical trials in a one-off setting is profoundly labor-intensive and expensive. And so what happens there is you save money and you save time. And so the innovation cycle tightens up. And that's exactly what PCORI is trying to do. Because all of us here today and all the members of PCORI understand that with our aging society, we have the possibility that has been outlined by the UN health ministers in 2013 that major chronic diseases will consume 50% of the gross national productivity of our nation and of every nation across the planet, and that's just not sustainable. So we have 20 years to try to get ahead of this. Managing information is the key strategy.
Thank you so much. And Dr. Nguyen, we've just kind of asked every panelist to give a 5-minute overview of their work, and then we're going to go into a facilitated conversation around some of these issues.
Sure. I'm going to start off with sort of saying that I think the approach that we have is trying to get within the philosophy of Willie Sutton, who was a famous bank robber at one point, who sort of said when he's finally caught, why do you rob banks? And he goes, what do you mean? That's where the money is. In a similar fashion, I think that when we talk about our clinical trials and our studies, we have to consistently ask ourselves, are we where the money is? One prime example of that is sarcoid. I was just at the national meeting on sarcoidosis, and I quickly recognized that the people who are actually involved in most of the studies, who will actually have access to most of our technology, have a median income well over $100,000. And it struck me that says, but if you look at our data, based on CDC data and everywhere else, we know that the vast majority of the patients in the United States anyways with sarcoid tend to be African-American. And interestingly enough, if you look at those neighborhoods like Englewood and other things like that, again, don't actually have or may have some people well over 100,000, but the median income is not. So the question again Willie Sutton asks is, are we where the money is? Since I was a med school student at Michigan, there has always been a mantra. We've said it. Go blue. Although we're that's right. and one of those was bench to bedside. And when I was a resident, we talked bench to bedside. And when I was a fellow, we talked bench to bedside. It was always bench to bedside. But really, inherently, that implies that it stops at the bedside in a hospital. But when you're talking about in the 21st century about new technologies and new innovations and cost sharing, why aren't we talking about from bench to community? Why aren't we really talking about low-cost measures of being able to identify these things and put them in the hands of not only our super subspecialists, which, by the way, I have to do for transparency's sake, a pulmonary critical care guy who runs an NIH-funded lab looking at specifically lung cancer pathways, but it dawned on me that why am I looking at these pathways if at the end of the day we're not trying to get them in the hands of our primary care docs, or at least get them into the hands of our community folks so that we're actually having an impact where sometimes the disease burden is the highest. When we talk about big data, I started thinking about if you get big data on sarcoid and it doesn't really involve the population that actually is majorly affected by it, then how good is that data? Now, I do think that this has been driven, and I'll get to what we're doing in one second. This has been driven by, in my mind, an argument similar to Copernicus. Hopefully, the concept will be that I will not be burned at the stake or even have the threat of being burned at the stake. But I think during this period of time, we had this constant argument that the brightest minds were arguing with Copernicus, who sort of was the little guy, said, wait a minute, I don't think that the sun revolves around the earth. I think it's the other way. In a similar manner, I will tell you that in the 21st century, that like Copernicus, I think that we also in the medical field, in the health services field, have also suffered from a little bit about what revolves around what. And it's not, we've for decades have considered that the patients revolve around us. Maybe it's time to think about how we revolve around them and how do we get more into those communities. Now, again, that's a very hippie granola approach. When you're talking high technology and I'm talking about my molecule that I've identified or my chip that I want to run, we sort of say, well, that's it. But again, if you adopt the fact that we have to get beyond the bedside into communities, because that's where the real money is, that's where the real disease is, that's where the real action is, the biggest challenge of the 21st century is not only technology, which I believe in, but the implementation and the placement of these technologies into our areas that it's going to matter the most. that's where our big brains and our big minds are sort of going to have to sort of be implemented. In a couple seconds that I actually have, one of the concepts that we've had to sort of address this in both my hats as an associate vice president of health affairs, dealing mostly with a primary care base and a cancer center director, dawned on me, wait a minute. What if I brought my super subspecialist and figured out a platform in which we could actually get access for the folks in the community, my primary care folk, to be directly linked somehow to the cancer center? And so it began that we are trying this audacious and really bold move of having a very, and ideally maybe the first, but hopefully many others, comprehensive, community-focused cancer center that will definitely be not only looking at understanding the basic science, which I love, of cancer, but trying to get, how do we get into the undergirding of the things that support the patients that we say we're trying to treat. Now, we've not looked at FQHCs in a very good way in decades. I'm going to tell you that London Baines Johnson and the people who came up with the concept of federally qualified health centers, these community health centers, did something that was fantastic in the 60s. They sort of said, look, we have a population of people as part of our war on poverty that we need to reach. How are we going to do that? They did a bold step in sort of saying, well, maybe there ought to be some equality, and that equality is that maybe we should have health services in the poorest areas, in the most underserved and under-resourced areas, so that we would reach those populations. It was a bold move in the 60s. The problem with it has been that in over 50 years, places like Lincoln Park compared to Inglewood not only have primary care access, which is very important, by the way, but they also have specialty care access and access to clinical trials and access to whole lots of things, which you might say folks in Inglewood would say, well, we don't care about that except for when you run into a couple of reverends on the street who sort of say, well, why do you guys over where you are in those fancy places get all those miracle cancer drugs and we don't have access to any of that? Not an unreasonable question. The biggest challenge is the development of how do you get these big technology and the hopes of what we have in the concept of what technology can bring to the people it could potentially also best serve. That's the struggle. And so I am pushing our guys and pushing everyone that is willing to listen that as we talk about our big imaging systems, we talk about efficient imaging systems that could be low cost, that could potentially be mobile, that could be moved into small places. If we can do it internationally on a global level, in areas like Harare, in Zimbabwe, in areas of India, why shouldn't we be thinking about going right across the street in the South and West Side and figuring out how those types of technologies could also work to help better serve? So I think with that, I think I'll stop if that was.
Oh, absolutely. And I think that we can all tell just from the overview that we've heard from the panelists so far that we're in for a very good and very interesting discussion. So our panelists work in very different systems, and of course, I know you've heard throughout the day that that is one of the real strengths of the Illinois Medical District is that, you know, we have these really influential and quality medical and research centers that are all right here, but they serve a very diverse and very different population base, and yet there's a theme here that you know that we're hearing across these systems around. The use of translational research and clinical data, and how do you best make that connection between research findings and the practice of medicine, and how do you even go beyond that and not only think about that from bench to bedside, but from bench to community, and of course the very importance of having sophisticated systems so that we can be utilizing data and tracking outcomes and tracking new medications that come out and have those systems in place. So the next question that I want to pose to our panelists, and I'm going to start again with Dr. Shannon for this one, is it's important to have clinical data, and obviously translational research and clinical data are increasingly tied together. But yet, we really have this the situation now where the capabilities and of collecting data and the need for sophisticated data analytics has really kind of exploded in a in an exciting way, but I know in a way that has created, challenges for researchers. In being able to, to really effectively utilize that in translational research and applying that to the delivery of healthcare. So as the CEO of our largest Chicagoland safety net hospital, and understanding many of the the evolution that you are trying to see happen within the Cook County system, I'm very interested in your perspective on, what are the challenges that you are facing and that you are looking to overcome in making sure that the application, that the latest research is embedded into the delivery of care and the management of the patients that you your system is taking responsibility for, mm-hmm. as you're moving into more of this insurance-based model.
Right. Well, I think one of the things that you're raising, Crystal, really has to do with the question of what is research. One of the things that when the member organizations that culminated in the successful grant, the PCORI grant that resulted in Capricorn, one of the conversations that kept bubbling up when we were meeting here early in the morning back in 2013 was, are these questions around research or are these questions around better patient care? And this kind of traditional dichotomy between this is care and this is clinical investigation is, I think, blurring quite a bit for a number of different reasons. One of the reasons is that I think, frankly, our elected officials at the federal level have said, we're not getting the juice for the amount of squeeze that we're putting into clinical research, and we want to see more action that actually improves the health of our community. Even though we've built up these great research enterprises, the question is, how are they measurably impacting the health of the people that we serve? So there's been a gradual disintegration, I would say, between this traditional dichotomy between healthcare delivery and clinical investigation. And I'll just use one example of this. We've been challenged as an organization trying to figure out how to take the finite number of dollars that we have to provide better care for the patients that we have. And one approach that we take, and is a very democratic and egalitarian kind of place, I think, that I've worked in most of my life, and we think we should offer the same kind of care to everybody that we see. But one of the things that we've discovered over the past many years is that it turns out to be very inefficient to operate that way. And we're far better off if we use information that we've collected, kind of as Dr. Mulshine was alluding to do predictive modeling. This is a relatively new field of data analytics, to do predictive modeling and to say, well, it may be true that you've got 100 people in the room, but only 5 of them are at risk for a particular kind of a condition. And you really ought to focus the limited energies or resources that you've got on those 5, because if you can reduce their risk profile, then the whole group looks a whole lot better. I'll give you the example here. A number of years ago, investigators from our institution and a handful of others did what sounds like a ridiculous clinical trial, but it was an important one to do. And they recognized from their own clinical practice that when they took care of homeless people, it was pretty hard to make them better. And the problem was, the homeless patient may or may not come back to your clinic. You frequently saw them in the ER, you frequently saw them in the hospital, but you couldn't get them back in the clinic. So they actually applied for and got funding to do a randomized controlled trial where they took a bunch of patients who came in who were homeless and had clinical problems, and they randomized them into 2 groups. This group we're going to take care of the way we've always taken care of. This group, we're going to try our darndest to get them into stable housing and figure out if that improves their health. And what do you think the punchline of that study was? It did. And it did it in a way that actually not only improved the health for individuals, but it lowered the cost of care for those individuals. A big aha moment. This is a front page story in JAMA about 5 years ago. Now you fast forward, and we've estimated at the end of 2012 that there are about 350,000 adults that we think are going to be eligible for Medicaid expansion come the Affordable Care Act in 2014. And as people in the room, I think, are aware, The county system got a waiver to early enroll those individuals into a Medicaid managed care plan called County Care. Well, as part of that enrollment, when we were taking applications from these individuals, we did a very commonly used instrument that's called a health risk assessment. And the health risk assessment was done telephonically by low clinical skill individuals, but they would simply ask the person on the end of the phone, do you mind if I ask you a few questions while we're taking your application for Medicaid? One of the questions that they asked was, do you have concerns about where you will be living in the next month? It turned out that 19%, and this proportion has hung rock steady at that, 19% said yes. This meant that they were either on the streets or they were living on a family member's couch. And that's a very profound risk factor for having a bad health outcome. So if I've got two applicants, one of them's got diabetes and answered yes to that question. One of them has diabetes and answered no. I don't have any concerns about where I'm going to be living. I've just been able to use, at a very simplistic level, predictive modeling to say I need to put more resources with that first person. And the last illumination I would use on this kind of thematic approach to identifying risky individuals is one from my last institution, which was a safety net system in Dallas. And a number of us were involved in a study that looked at readmission because, as everybody knows, we get penalized for readmissions for heart failure. We had a very large, very expensive electronic health record system there. And one of my colleagues at that institution recognized that if you threw in to the cardiology tests, you know, the ejection fraction, hypertension, and things like this, if you threw in a couple of social determinants that were easily found within the electronic health record, you vastly outperformed the Medicare risk predictive modeling for heart failure readmissions. So two of the factors that were thrown into that equation were a positive drug screen, a positive urine drug screen that was done, and the second, again, was the number of times the individual had changed her registration address in the electronic health record, talking about housing instability again. And lo and behold, those two factors vastly outperformed traditional physiologic metrics to tell you who was likely to come back into the hospital after they'd been hospitalized for heart failure. So these are ways that you can start to harness what you know about clinical medicine and what you know about the reality, where reality hits the road. As Dr. Wynn was talking about, if most people with sarcoid in this country are poor, that's where we ought to be looking. And you can see this intersection between good ideas, big data, but you still have to do the investigation and then apply known science to see improved outcomes.
Thank you. Dr. Mollschein, I'm going to move to you, and you have a perspective from Rush University Medical Center where you have both a direct connection to the students at Rush University as well as that link to the clinicians and the practice of medicine and hospital leadership. So I'm going to pose the same question and you know, want to hear your perspective on how the what are some ways that academia and you know, clinicians can work together to more efficiently and effectively make sure, I guess, that you know, that the promise of this clinical data and translational research actually is you know, is played out and experienced at the patient level.
Yes. So that's a daily challenge and a very important one. And I would point out that there are challenges that are financial in terms of doing the things that we know are important in a sustainable way. And, you know, we're here talking about Capricorn and PCORI, and that's a function that came out under the Affordable Care Act. And the Affordable Care Act is much maligned, and I believe it's sausage, but I think it's necessary sausage, because embedded in that is an effort to try to pivot us from doing heart transplants in end-stage people who theoretically could have been spared all that if they had gotten primary care 25 years earlier, and moved to this more preventive model. And in terms of what does that mean? That means that like smoking is one of the most unfortunate habits we have in our society. And that, and full disclosure, Bob and I share a passion around lung cancer for some years now. And it's a disease that caused lung cancer, COPD, heart disease, lots of other things. It's a disease that starts in childhood. And it's one of the few things that a decision you make when you're 14, you know, plagues you for the rest of your life. And inexplicably, in our society prior to the Affordable Care Act, the ability to, you know, figure out anything about advice to stop smoking and access to the drugs that could potentially assist you in stop smoking, which is a brutally hard thing to do, were not provided. It's the same type of thing as what Jay was talking about in terms of housing. You know, you have readmissions because of housing. You have readmissions because people continue to smoke. And we would pay for your admission to the ICU unit, but we won't pay for your access to the drugs that can help you stop smoking, however you know limited they are in their utility. But they do work, and we do have 45 million people in our society that have stopped smoking. So one of the things is the Affordable Care Act provides new CPT codes to provide a whole slew of preventive services, including cancer services. And they do it without a copay. Because as much as some of these other factors block people getting adequate care, even a $20, $50, whatever it is, copay winds up being an incredible barrier. And we know that because we've done the research and we found out about the actual delivery of care in different settings. So what we need to do is try to figure out these very, very small but important issues that lead to chronic disease being the problem it is. And a lot of it are related to social determinants, but some of it's related to also medical and technological opportunities as well in terms of providing better outcomes. And we've got to be strategic and step back and look at how we approach these various problems and figure out how to substitute, you know, efficiency and impact for some of the frantic, you know, and the very expensive late stage interventions we make. And that's a real challenge, but I think that you know having our students think about that and think strategic and think critically and not just accept the paradigm as it is a wonderfully empowering opportunity for them as well.
Thank you. Dr. Nguyen, kind of building on the conversation here, what do you see as the opportunities for clinical data and translational research in reducing health disparities?
And I'll try to keep my comments brief, but I've really enjoyed these last comments because in a nutshell for me, it's really a post-Flexner world in which we're trying to say, how does academic excellence, which we all have lived our whole lives for, how does that translate into an academic relevant model? And in fact, I think that that underlining the academic relevant model or in the 21st century, how do you get academic centers to be relevant to, and you know, you can fill in the blanks, but clearly to some of these communities that are very much in need. I personally think that the technology, from my mind, really is one of these things that if we can get it small, and I know we're going to a bigger iPhone now, but because, you know, I kind of figured that as I'm getting older, I too need a bigger screen. I didn't recognize that. But there is an element of being portable, being affordable, being light, and the ability for people to understand it is going to be helpful. Big data helps me the following way. If I, for example, I actually was just told by two of my guys, Scott and Chris, who one's from University of Michigan and the other one's from Williams. And the crazy thing about it is that when I was talking to them about Google Maps, I was under the false impression that it came from some satellite. And so I always wondered, how was that satellite going to see my front door on my street with these parked cars? They quickly recognized and told me that, you know, that's not how it goes. They have a guy like me with a hat and a helmet on, driving around on the streets. And that was an epiphany for me that really the best data we get is when we're there. So we can always talk about this distant data and collecting of distant data, but the best data you're going to get, the best intel you're going to get to actually be able to affect change is really when you're there. So we've done a small experiment in the context of how we're going to employ technology, and I'll just take 2 seconds. We figured out that we know that there isn't a such, well, coming from Colorado, I had to figure out what a ward. So we got all these wards together, and then I started figuring out, well, the wards really aren't exactly complete wards like they in the map I saw in the 1950s and 1960s. And all of a sudden, they were based on all the elections and where people got. So we were, like, struggling. We were like, well, you know, the IDPH is struggling with the CDPH. How do we actually get to where we need to be? So we made an interesting decision. It's a practical decision to focus on what we call our ambulatory care networks that's around our health center. So we said, look, we have places in South Shore and Englewood and Cicero and Back of the Yards over at Main Mile Square. What if we conceptually just thought about having a person attached to that from the community? And so we picked the alderman. And we essentially said, alderman, I know your wards aren't like they were in the 1950s, but I do know that you're in control of something. So we tried to pick the wards that were immediately adjacent to our ambulatory centers. And believe it or not, it turns out that our data is actually probably cleaner for the incidence, the prevalence of the disease, the mortality, at least that not only is important to us as academicians, but interesting enough is important to those aldermen. So we've always thought about academic centers and technology as we generate the academic stuff and we generate it. But the interesting thing is you have a partner. I always say that the best apps aren't really made by Google. The best apps are made when they beta test it and they send it to the coffee shops and people go, I want to use this app, or here's how you would use this app. So our technology is really going to be influenced significantly if we allow it by being more boots on the ground and being much more engaged in those communities.
Thank you. Dr. Baringholtz. So we know that military medicine has a long history of impacting civilian medicine. So I'm actually very interested in your perspective on this. Can you speak to how clinical data and translational research is applied, you know, within your work at the Jesse Brown VA Medical Center?
Thank you, and thank you again for inviting me to participate in this panel. I certainly have a long-standing perspective for more than 25 years, as I said, being at VA. One of the challenges that we have is that our population has a heavy burden of chronic disease, and I think this is the population that consumes health care to a larger degree than perhaps other population that is healthier, and adjusting what we learn in research to this patient population, I think it's challenging. On the other hand, it's revealing. One of the important challenges and opportunities in VA system specifically is mental health. Mental health weighs heavily in our population, and putting together what other panelists said, I agree that social milieu of patients weighs heavily on what patient presents with and how they consume health care. Again, in that way, I can say that I've seen VA really integrating the data and advancing, for example, from social perspective, addressing the way patient lives. Social workers play a very important role. And now that we are able to see what is going in patient life even more than previously, because previously we were not able to see, for example, psychiatric care, and now it's integrated with our usual electronic health data, and the social way the patient care is addressed shows me as a researcher and as a clinician right away where the patient uses mental health services more and social services. For example, the homelessness certainly plays an important role, and I can see it right away, for example, and integrate it in my health approach. So PTSD, the post-traumatic stress disorder, even in my smallest study that I'm completing right now, weighs heavily on how we integrate what the data had told us. And the recent study that I put in PTSD and diabetes, which that's what I do as endocrinologist, show that PTSD weighs, as a matter of fact, very heavily on what the data shows. And a simple intervention as exercise that recently been used for this population shows that just 30 minutes of exercise improves the ways people feel and improves the health outcomes. And if we look at exercise, it's also as important for obesity or for diabetes, that again, my area of interest and clinical approach, and in Alzheimer's disease. Or for example, the traumatic brain injury that plays important role and leads to post-traumatic stress disorder and then to any other disease you can think of. Is important for VA, but it would be applicable to mm-hmm. other patient populations. So I think that what we learn from VA population and military population certainly is important for other communities, and doing collaborative research, integrating that population with all other population would be very important.
Thank you. I'm going to ask one more question before we open it up to the audience. And I think it's definitely been touched on here. And that is the idea that in translational research, I think there's a growing recognition that it's more and more important to engage the patient community. And that you have to do that in all steps of the process. You have to do that in, you know, when you're, sometimes even when you're trying to set the research agenda and, you know, and then how to design that, how to engage the patients. And to the point that Dr. Nguyen raised, how you then make sure that you are attracting the right clinical subjects and, you know, and building that those relationships. So I'm not going to take this in any particular order. Hopefully it won't be a free-for-all, but I'm going to throw the question out there about, you know, your thoughts on how, what are the challenges of that? How do we best engage the patient populations in the research, and how ultimately will that make translational research more effective? Just, you know, in 30 seconds or now.
Well, I'll take a quick crack at it. I think that one way, and I learned this the painful hard way, and that is that you can't do what people in the community refer to as parachute research. You parachute in, you gather your data, thank you very much, and you get airlifted out. So you have to have a commitment, I think, is an important piece, to not only share information back, and there are proven ways that you can show that you can bring information back and say, even if you haven't come up with a cure for the condition that you were studying, we're showing you what we learn from being in your community. That's an important area. Another way that you immediately grow strength is by including the participants and helping you to form the questions, because you get a better idea of what do they think is important, besides perhaps my very biased opinion as a clinician about what I think is the important question related to a disease. And I think it's a good opportunity to honor one of our recent losses in the community, Steve Whitman, at the Sinai Urban Institute, who taught us all about 20 years ago about the effectiveness of taking people from the community and making them your eyes, ears, and the community health workers that actually can be part of both the clinical trial work, but also an effector limb at lifting up the health of the community by being a community-dwelling, ongoing community resource. And so that concept of the community health worker, both as an adjuvant for research and as a contributor to the community health, is, I think, one way to do that.
Dr. Nguyen, something to add?
That was well said.
Okay.
I can perhaps add a few words from my own experience. We specifically wanted to address the issue of underserved community, for us specifically, it was African-American men, which in our VA represent majority, more than 60% of our population is that population. And I think that compared to other studies, even large studies where it was very difficult to attract this community, we were successful in this patient population because for our patients, the difference was feeling safe and secure in the place where they came, specifically our Jesse Brown VA, where there are many services where they feel that they are majority and they feel comfortable with what is going on and they feel, therefore, the face in the care that is being provided. And that is very important, this feeling of safety and being part of the like community is very important for patient participation in the research. And creating such environment, I would say, is very important for any research by whatever means is available. For us, it was right there because it was simply our patient population, because they felt comfortable there, they trusted in what we were suggesting. And creating the trust and creating the bond, I think, is very important and takes time. As you said, you have to go back to community, you have to address that, and that's how we approach that challenge.
Okay, very quickly, Dr. Nguyen, and then we're going to go to audience.
I also think it takes a cultural change on the academic medical centers. So it's not just on the communities. Our change is to think that everything we've grown up with has been you get to us and then we'll do something for you. I mean, my whole entire career, it's been you come to us and we'll do something for you. Then I started thinking, how does one who really even has a really bad disease burden, when you're talking about the amount of violence that are happening in our communities, when you're talking about the issue, real issues of, you know, commuting, to taking three buses and then a train to get here to our esteemed facilities, how does that work? And so there really is going to have to be, it's uncomfortable. But as we think about our studies and we think about our research and our technologies, we really do have to, from a cultural way, in an academic center, recognize that just because you're studying the PAX1 gene doesn't mean that it's only in your little petri dish in your lab.
So I know that we are, we're running a little bit late. We started late, so we're going to make sure that, you guys get your full hour. Very quickly, Dr. Mulshine, and then I promise audience questions.
And I'll be real quick. The question's about patient, and I appreciate and support what was said, but I, to touch on what Rob was just saying, you know, the 14-year-old child living in a Hispanic community, you know, within stone's throw of, this and our other establishments in the IMD, some of those communities have rates of obesity that are 40, 50, 60% of that population. Now, they're not patients yet by most people's definitions, but it's coming. And so this issue about community and thinking about health and how we be a healthy society, not a sick society, is an important part of how we conceptualize our solutions.
Absolutely. So, do we have any questions from the audience for our panelists? Yes. You can, yes, in the cream sweater, if you can speak up. I don't think we have microphones.
Well, I'll just say quickly, and I think Dr. Mulshine may be the best person to really get into the details of this from the clinical trial standpoint. it's still the case that the opposite is the reality, that is that poor populations and populations of color are vastly underrepresented in most clinical trials. Now, that may be transitioning as you're talking about. We're very proud that we've had for the last 12 years a National Cancer Institute minority grant that has allowed our organization to get many more people into clinical trials around cancer than has historically been the case for a whole variety of different reasons. As it relates to the actual insurance funding for and the problem, as some of the comments have pointed out, the problem is that you find out that things aren't always the same when you take a clinical trial that was done in a very very narrow population and you try to apply it more generally. The problem of reimbursement around the insurance carriers, I think, Jim, is that something you could take a swing at?
I think there's lots of issues with this, and I think fundamentally, you know, we work in translational teams with the pharmaceutical companies, and we work with the device companies, and we work with the biomedical engineers. The insurance companies got to get in the party, because they just can't wait and hope that it comes over the transom. This is a very thorny problem, lots of different dimensions to this, and they've been keeping their trousers very clean on the sidelines. That's got to change.
All right, thank you. Did you still have a question? The green scarf? Yes.
Dr. Wynn mentioned Flexner and you mentioned cultural change. So I was wondering, in your opinion as physicians, is medical education changing fast enough to address this population health bench to community health?
So I'll take a quick swing at that, and then, but I do think these guys are going to be better at it. I'll wear my former hat as an admissions dean at University of Colorado, and saying that I think that people know Flexner, but they don't actually really, if you get beyond what Flexner, what people know about him, you actually know about the innovative things he did for his culture and the context and society. For example, I don't think most people recognize that it was Flexner who was a really big advocate in making certain that at the time, minority African-Americans more at the time were part of the medical and delivering of care. So if you really go back to the story of Flexner, Flexner is more than I understood. So it's really, to me, the next iteration of Flexner, meaning that he, at that point, was really trying to do things societal beyond just what he taught about the education, to sort of say there is this social aspect. We don't really talk about the social aspects of what Flexner did, but he was a really amazing guy in that sort of context. That, using that as my inspiration, I really figured that we needed to get a class that was really, in fact, when I picked my class, I never actually looked at race. And I know I'm saying that, and you're going to say, what the hell? That's probably, you know, you always look at race, because you don't. You look at whole people. In fact, we used to tell my class that we encourage you to look at patients as whole people. So why wouldn't the admission process look at you as a whole person? Right? Since that's a first point of first contact. So are we keeping up? No, because things are changing so rapidly. It's like I can't even keep up with the freaking phone thing. I mean, it's the technologies are sort of changing, and lots of these pressures are changing. But are we taking the right directions? I really do think so. I think that the young people that I run into are really refreshing for me, because they do, just like at Google, they talk about the societal aspect as well as doing. There is much more of a consciousness with some of our younger people. We just have to be careful not to beat it out of them.
I can also jive in, because I am one of the educationalists, you can call, for our medical school. And what I have seen from my perspective as a clinician and what students are taught in, I think that I agree with you that we are lacking, particularly in the preventive medicine subject. For example, it's been shown by research time and again that the simplest approach for prevention is nutrition and exercise. And perhaps, you know, quitting smoking and some other simplest measure that overall would be so inexpensive to society and would improve healthcare delivery and healthcare overall and cost of healthcare tremendously. Yet medical students are not educated enough in those subjects. For example, nutrition as a science is represented very sporadically and very little in their education. Or kinesiology, which University of Illinois, for example, has it as a separate study for allied health professions, is not represented for medical students, maybe perhaps at all. And this becomes very important when they become clinicians and realize that, as a matter of fact, research nowadays, if you hear about anything, nutrition and exercise, figures out as heavy as social part, again, I would say, is not taught perhaps at all, and importance of it, those three factors, if you integrate, because smoking cessation, for example, or other simple preventive measures go into social, addressing the social problems, or problem of homelessness, or of low socioeconomic status, weighs heavily in addressing challenges in medical approaches to chronic disease, and that is not taught, I think, to the important degree in medical in medical education.
Yeah, quickly. So I'm a physician, and as the associate provost research, I get to work across our colleges, and so I would agree with the two previous comments, but I would say just to reassure you that if us physicians don't get it right, the nurses are going to do it.
That's true. That's true. That's true. That's
true. All right, I think we have time for one last question.
That's true.
Yes.
As Kristen Cooper, I'm a clinical psychologist at Strozier's, and I've actually worked in the VA and at Rush. And I've heard, you know, just to piggyback on the most recent comment, that all of the comments really are implicating a lot of behavioral health and other specialties surrounding. And I just was wondering, to what extent do you see more funding being put for these positions? To inform how we collect data, to inform how we actually create this change to healthier living.
I was going to take a quick, I think that there is much more consciousness of it, and so people are aware, and I guess that's the first part of solving any problem, is to be aware that you have a lack of or a problem. But the movement towards it, there's been more talk. I think that there has been than anything else. I do think more of us are moving towards being behavioral health, mental health. But I actually have one thing that, you know, that I really, that struck me, that interesting enough, when we build new health centers, we never talk about building health clusters. So even if we train our students, and even if we do what you say, we get more behavioralists and more. But the reality is, in an area like South Shore, for example, when the Dominics moved down on 71st Street, there is nothing there now. So we know that the health deserts, you know, the food deserts, health deserts, and the fitness deserts all exist. And yet, when we talk about building new ambulatory care centers or new hospitals, there is not an inkling of building. We do cluster hires. There's a lot of clusters we talk about, but never a health cluster. And meaning that you would actually say, as a health center, that you would at least be the advocate for the community to bring in something that would be maybe not a Whole Foods, but something that actually had really good produce, and bringing in a Planet Fitness or something like that, that would be the equivalent of easy accessibility, because nutrition and exercise and health kind of merge. So I'm hoping we move towards that model, but it hasn't happened.
Because they have long ago integrated with urban planners and nutritionists to look at some of these. So I think a lot of what you're talking about is not having listened to all of these voices that inform those models.
Yes, but safety in our parks would be just an incredibly important steps in an urban setting towards that.
And I can add that, for example, of what we said, I think we didn't mention motivation for physicians, motivation for patients, for example, motivational interviews that I did a recent grand round at University of Illinois, specifically addressed that behavior. How do you motivate people? In my case, at VA, for example, we have a lot of behavior modification. And as a matter of fact, one of the integrated systems that can serve as an example of what Dr. Wynn was talking about is MOVE program, which is a VA program for obesity, which integrate motivation of patients to do something and gives the patient open access for gym and for nutrition, and certainly can translate into big changes with just small effort if we can say so. Yes, integrating that and applying and showing that it works in the studies, I think, is important.
All right, so this has been a great conversation. I hope you all agree. And can we thank our panelists?